Good afternoon, Sravan.
How are you doing?
Good. How are you?
So I remember, was that last week you were in Miami?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was in Tampa.
And how was it?
It was great. It's great. Good family reunion. There were 18 people in the house.
18 people in one room?
Yeah. Not in one room, but it was a pretty big house.
Or a big house. All right. You guys shared the breakfast and stuff like that? Was it like a big community event or what?
Yeah, it was a big family gathering, and they had a very good time. The kids had time to play with each other.
Yeah.
So.
Are you ready for July 3rd?
Yes. Yes, I am.
The Kaboom Town in Addison, or you got something else planned for today?
I wasn't thinking that far ahead.
Really? So there's nothing happening tonight then?
I don't know. We'll have to see.
Yeah. Wonderful. Wonderful. So there's a lot going. By the way, Vish, you are director of data science programs at Divergence.
Yeah.
Right? And you're also CTO of Divergence.ai.
Yes. Yes. Right?
And you are, I guess, in a fortunate position to see what's happening in the industry and bring the best of industry to the academy, correct?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
And I was always proud to say that I'm the third student here in the Divergence Academy.
Yeah.
And back in the day, I was fortunate that you had one-on-one time, that I could get one-on-one time with you.
No, sorry, I cannot give you any of that time anymore.
Yeah, I know, right? Yeah. Recently, I'm also stepped into your shoes a little bit in terms of training the part-time data science program.
That's wonderful.
So I'm having a ball.
Yeah. What did you change? You know, if you don't mind, I mean, I took pride in the content curriculum I created, but you gave it a better shape. You did something cool this time around.
I mean, that's what we believe in, right? We always try to do something better the next time.
Yeah.
Right, we always believe that there's a better way of doing things.
Yeah,
and the philosophy stays the same. You know, if you look at the philosophy, it's literally about what is the minimum skill set that we need, minimum concepts that we need to do a particular task,
right,
and then keep getting better at it every single iteration. Right.
Right. Right. Any tools that you introduced? Anything new? Predominantly it was on Jupyter notebooks.
Yeah. So one of the big changes that we introduced this season is using Google Colab.
Yeah.
You know, if you remember, we used to spend a lot of time installing Jupyter. Yeah, just the setup process, installing Jupyter, installing the different tools. And, you know, we got away with that, and we said, okay, you know, we're just going to get virtual boxes. And all of a sudden, I open Google Drive one day, and then I see, hey, you know, I can just open a Jupyter notebook one day.
Right.
So I think that is very, very revolutionary, both from a training perspective.
Yes.
So, you know, I said this is a very, very quick way for people to start working on data science.
Sure.
So I converted a lot of your notebooks into Google Colab.
Sure.
Notebooks.
That's great. And we are doing something else too that's new, which is recording our classes.
Yeah. So the one thing, we are recording our classes. A couple of other things are for the first time we introduced deep learning.
Oh, that's great.
And
were there any specific frameworks you're using in the class?
We first start with TensorFlow,
okay,
and then take them to Keras. We do a lot of work in Keras,
right,
so that people understand like how to identify a problem, and for a specific problem, what kind of a network topology works. And Keras is a fairly widely used framework out there.
Sure.
That Google Colab, for example, directly supports out of the box. I don't even have to install Keras on any of the Google Colab notebooks.
Okay.
So it's very helpful.
That's wonderful. Wonderful. Anything else that you are planning on introducing as we wrap up our cohort number 16?
Right? Yeah.
16, two more weeks to go.
Yeah, two more weeks to go. You know, so far we've covered everything from statistics to machine learning to deep learning. Mostly we've been in the realm of supervised learning.
Okay.
So the students learn how to apply statistical classification techniques and
sure,
compare them with neural network techniques and see which one works in what scenario.
Right.
So I thought that was really important. We've really beaten to death on the concept of confusion matrix and how do you explain Bayesian Bayes algorithm. You know, Bayes.
The prior, the posterior.
The prior, the posterior. The
okay.
The Bayes probability theory.
Sure.
Based on that. So for me, it was a very good insight.
That's great.
Yeah. So. Yeah, and then, you know, we have unsupervised learning coming up. And again, the same thing, how do you do unsupervised learning using the classic statistics and machine learning ways like k-means clustering, like dbScan,
right.
But also how do you do unsupervised learning with things like text using Word2Vec and things,
sure.
things of that nature. So,
that's right.
Yeah, so I really like the way we're teaching now is to go with statistics first and machine learning first,
right.
Get an understanding of not just how the classifiers work, but make the interpretability a very high priority.
Sure.
And then we introduce them to neural networks and then compare them side by side.
That's
a pretty
awesome.
Good, we've been pretty happy about doing that.
Right. Today is July 3rd, there's fireworks tonight.
Yeah.
But there's a bigger fireworks that's going to start for us on the consulting side.
Oh yeah, yeah. I mean, like we had some phenomenal success with one of our $1 billion+ client.
Yes.
And they've been very happy with our marketing algorithms that we were able to productize.
Okay.
And you know, to be fair, we have to give a lot of credit to them.
Sure.
Because one of the things that I learned in this project is to be humble.
Sure.
And they were very, very surprisingly humble about it.
Expand on that, humble.
Well, I mean, like, you know, a lot of times you hear about ML can do this, AI can go change the world, but people
right.
forget that, you know, I as a data scientist,
sure.
I understand machine learning algorithms, AI, I understand a little bit of marketing, but I don't know their specific company and their specific domain. Their specific domain. And if you go with the attitude that, oh, you know, I'm an AI expert and I can do all this,
sure.
you know, it kind of reduces the collaboration.
Sure.
What really helped in the case with our, you know, our client is that they were very receptive to the idea that, you know, they know what they know very
sure.
well, and they actually also knew what they don't know.
Sure.
So they were able to really work with us very well to explain to us, you know, what their domain is about, and we've been able to, like, you know, we went with very interpretable models.
Sure.
So when we explained it to them, they were like, you know, they were just gut reactions. It was to pull, like, this is not going to work, Vish, or
right.
there's something not right about this, even
sure.
though they didn't know specifics about,
right.
you know, they probably didn't even understand precise definitions of precision and recall, but they were just able to say, hey, this model will not work.
Right. So was there a specific type of machine learning model you built? You know, there are a lot of things like recommendation engines, personalization, attribution models, next best marketing offers, lookalikes. Was there something specific?
It was more like, I mean, it's a marketing recommender / next best offer kind of problems that we were trying to tackle.
Sure.
And as far as complexity is concerned, we tried to keep it simple
sure.
because we wanted to make sure that, you know, in a corporate environment, it's very common to get, you know, tens of different sources.
Sure.
And you have very limited time to first prove your value.
Right.
So we limited our scope to about 3 to 4 different data sets, and we just and the 3-4 data sets are something that were recommended to
sure.
us by the domain experts.
Sure.
So so that way we actually got a head start, and within 2 to 3 weeks we're able to see some signal in there.
Sure. And now we get to actually bring some of those learnings back to the classroom.
Absolutely. Right. I mean, that's one of the advantages that I see when I go and teach. You know, there are people coming from all different backgrounds. Like, I have a student that's a PhD in political science. I have a engineer coming from Verizon, coming from Citi.
Sure.
They are all DevOps, and they have a lot of experience with the cloud, and
right.
they're trying to see how they can leverage machine learning and log analytics and things of
sure.
that nature.
Sure.
So when I go and not just explain to them confusion matrix and area under the curves and how do you select a specific probability, I can explain to them from various different perspectives.
Right, right. Now that's what I think is the beauty of a program, which is having a CTO, working professional, who's seen a lot of different areas. You also worked at DI and AT&T, and you have a huge background on telecom. You can mesh it. You can bring
mm-hmm.
it bring it home.
Absolutely. I mean, like, a lot of things that I'm very surprised about when I moved over from embedded systems and telecom into data science is how much of a transfer of skill that there is.
Sure.
Right? You just have to think differently. I was not really from the enterprise world.
Right.
But really, I mean, because I was able to do a lot of embedded programming, you really had to understand how the processes worked, and you had to understand the command line really well.
Sure.
And majority of the time, in the end, you have to put a model in production, and all those skills really come into play.
No, that's great. That's great. So we got plenty of good stuff coming.
Mm-hmm.
We are as a academy, we are trying to bring ML into security.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Machine learning meets cybersecurity.
Mm-hmm.
And we're also trying to bring cloud computing. So for us, data science meets cybersecurity in the cloud. It's
mm-hmm.
not a cliche. It's not something we're trying to have a tagline. But I think it's more to do with how the industry is moving. Everybody's building their products in the cloud. So data science, cybersecurity, everything we do at the academy, our infrastructure happens to be in the cloud too.
Absolutely,
right.
Absolutely.
Right.
And that's an area that I'm really excited about. Although I don't claim to be any expert in cybersecurity, I know how important it is to every organization.
Right.
And the way that I think about it is, you know, you have a lot of logs. Like
right.
if somebody tries to log in, there's a log somewhere off that event happening.
Correct.
It's really about how do you identify these events.
Right.
So then it becomes a matter of like, how do you do log analysis?
Sure.
And tools like Elastic come into play.
Sure.
Your traditional machine learning comes into play.
Right. You're talking about Elk, right? The whole stack. Elastic, Logstash,
absolutely.
Kibana.
Uh-huh.
Okay. That's a good one.
And it's really the way they think about it is like, how do you monetize the data again, right?
Sure.
You know, marketing people look at point of sale data. They look at clickstream data.
Right.
And you know, security companies need to be looking at you know, log data.
Sure.
That's their asset.
Sure.
Really. And
sure.
You know, the more label data they have,
right.
The better their algorithms can be.
Right. Now, so, you know, let's continue this conversation. This is I would say chit chats,
yeah.
or a CTO and a founder talk. We're going to do more of these, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Right. I want you to enjoy July 4th. Happy 4th, everybody. And let's go cracking, right?